Hi, and welcome back to the essay Genealogies of Indian Literature by P.P. Ravindran. So we are almost reaching towards the end of the essay, and I hope that all the concepts that we have discussed so far is clear for all of you. All right. The last part that we discussed was about how, you know, the Orientalist idea of the East was presented in Western literature, and how you know, they were completely against regional and local cultures. They only wanted to highlight what was, according to them, originally Oriental, right? And then we went on to talk about the first Indian English writers like Michael Madhusudan and Dutt, and and how, you know, just like Mungi Wathiyengo from Kenya, they also, even though they began writing in English in the earlier period of their writing careers, they then, during the period of their writing maturity, they shifted to their regional language, that was Bengali. And this is because they believe that, you know, it is only in your native language that you can best express yourself. And also they believe that, you know, continuing this tradition of using the colonizer's language will not help them be completely free. So it was their way of becoming free, to get rid of the colonizer's language as such. All right. So the next subheading that we are going to discuss now is called the language question. History repeats. We have already heard this quote a lot, right? That history repeats itself. But Ravindran here says that history repeats, that is correct, and not always as farce. That means it's not always a dramatic, comical repetition that happens. All right. This is what we have to gather from the recurrence of the debate on the feasibility of using English language by Indians for creative purposes in post-independence India. Okay, so this is what we should understand, that history repeats itself, but not always as, you know, comically, dramatically. And what this is what we should understand, the fact that, you know, history repeats itself is what we should understand by, you know, from the recurrence of the debate. There is a recurring debate, there is a continuous debate that keeps coming up on the feasibility, on the possibility, on the, you know, on the work, if whether using English language by Indians for their creative purposes is right or wrong. Is it feasible or not? Is a recurring debate, all right, that happens in India. But what scholars like Buddhadev Bose, who was a very famous Indian scholar, and P. Lal could not prove through their theoretical perambulations in the 1950s and 1960s, the novelists of Rushdie's generation a few years later have shown through practice that the language question, framed as a question pertaining to the perceived spontaneity of creative expression, after all, was a non-question for politics as far as politics of writing was concerned. So what Ravindra is saying here is that earlier scholars like Buddhadev Bose and P. Lal, okay, they tried very hard to prove this point that, you know, you cannot use the colonizer's language for creative expression. But they could not prove this through their theoretical perambulations, he called. Perambulations means, you know, just walking around and throwing words here and there, all right? So they tried very much to prove it, but they could not prove it, all right? But it was only later, in the 1950s and the 60s, the novelist of Salman Rushdie's generation, all right, we're going to learn a novel by Rushdie. So it was only the people of Rushdie's generation a few years later, all right, Buddhadev Bose and P. Lal, who did not try to bring out any theory, unlike Buddhadev Bose and P. Lal. They did not begin with theoretical perambulations. Rather, they have shown this through practice. What have they shown? That the language question, okay, the language question is not a question at all. As far as the politics of writing is concerned, that means when you consider whether a foreign language or an alien language can be used for creative expression, it's not a question at all. Because why can't it be a question? Because of the spontaneity of creative expression. If creative expression is not something, according to them, that is, you know, thought about for a long, long time, it is spontaneous. Just like Wordsworth defined, right? And defined poetry as the spontaneous overflow of powerful emotions. Adubole, spontaneous aayittu varuna onnaana creative expression. And if it is spontaneously coming in the English language or in any alien language for that matter, that means it's not a question. അല്ലെ, അത് നമുക്ക് വളരെ നാച്ചുറലി ആ ഭാഷ വരുന്നുവെങ്കിൽ വൈ ഇസ് ദാറ്റ് അൻ ഇഷ്യൂ എന്നുള്ളതാണ് ഇവിടുത്തെ പ്രശ്നം വരുന്നത്. വൺ കുഡ് എക്സൽ ആൻഡ് പ്രൂവ് ടു ബി എ ക്രിയേറ്റീവ് ജീനിയസ് ഇൻ എൻ ഏലിയൻ ലാംഗ്വേജ്. ഓക്കെ, വൺ ക്യാൻ ഡു ദാറ്റ്. ഇവേഡിംഗ് ഇൻ ദ പ്രോസസ് ഓൾ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് പെർട്ടൈനിങ് ടു ദ പോളിറ്റിക്സ് ഓഫ് റൈറ്റിംഗ്. അപ്പൊ ആ കോളനൈസറുടെ ഭാഷയിൽ എഴുതണോ എഴുതണ്ടയോ എന്നുള്ളതാണ് പോളിറ്റിക്സ് ഓഫ് റൈറ്റിംഗിൽ ഉദ്ദേശിക്കുന്നത്. ഓക്കെ, സോ സ്വന്തമായിട്ട് ഒരു ഏലിയൻ ലാംഗ്വേജിൽ നന്നായിട്ട് എക്സൽ ചെയ്ത് എഴുതാൻ സാധിക്കുന്നുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ദെൻ ദ പോളിറ്റിക്സ് ഓഫ് റൈറ്റിംഗ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് എ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ. ഓൾറൈറ്റ്, ദെർ ഇസ് നോ നീഡ് ടു ആൻസർ എനി ഓഫ് ദീസ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ്. ദിസ് ഒബ്സർവേഷൻ ഗെയിൻസ് ഇമെൻസ് വാല്യൂ വെൻ വി റിമെമ്പർ ദറ്റ് സച്ച് പോളിറ്റിക്സ് വാസ് പ്രിസൈസ്ലി വാട്ട് ബൻകിം ചന്ദ്ര ആൻഡ് എം എം ദാസ് വർ ഇൻഡയറക്ട്ലി കൺസേൺഡ് വിത്ത് വെൻ ദേ തോട്ട് ഇറ്റ് ഫിറ്റ് ടു റിജക്ട് ദ ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ലാംഗ്വേജ് ആസ് എ മീഡിയം ഓഫ് ക്രിയേറ്റീവ് എക്സ്പ്രഷൻ ഇൻ ദ 19th സെഞ്ച്വറി. ഓൾറൈറ്റ്, സോ this observation that you know you can write in any language for that matter is very much important, is of much value. Okay, when is it of much value? When we remember that such politics, you know, when writers of Rushdie's generation are completely rejecting this political question of language, this political question of writing in the colonizer's tongue was what forced Bankim Chandra Chatterjee and M.M. Dutt to reject the colonizer's language English and choose their own language. All right, so they were indirectly concerned with this question, even though they did not say it directly. They were indirectly concerned with this fact. All right, and that is why they saw it fit to reject the English language as a medium of creative expression in the 19th century. And certainly one should also remember that the writers of Rushdie's generation were working in an altered cultural environment. All right, so we have to remember that even though there's not much of a periodical difference between Rushdie and people like Bankim Chandra and Michael Madhusudan Dutt, what we have to remember is that the time period is not significant, but the altered cultural environment, adhaayatha kaalagattathinte attitude of that generation was completely different. They lived in an altered cultural environment. That means the cultural environment was not the same anymore. The independence had happened, partition had happened, there was a lot of things were going on. All right, so in an altered cultural environment in which literature itself has been listed in the service of an unscrupulous global and globalized economic order by contemporary capitalism. Okay, so what has happened? What is the difference in the cultural environment? Literature itself, all right, it has come under capitalism. Ennaana parayaga, that means it's no longer just a creative expression. It has become a very much a part of the global and globalized economic order. All right, it's not something that's separated from the economic order anymore. It has become very much a part of the economic order, and by extension it is now a part of contemporary capitalism. Since this is not the place to go into the details of that development, let us leave that aspect and elaborate it for the present. So the fact of how literature became a capitalist enterprise is not our debate for today. So that's why Ravindran is leaving it at that one sentence. This problem concerning the language of literature will appear to be more relevant in a discussion of Indian literature, as literature is always written in a specific language. So that is our issue. Usually when you have titles like Canadian literature, Australian literature, Caribbean literature, they have issues of language. But when you talk about American literature and British literature, there is a uniformity of language that has been used. All right, but in mostly post-colonial states and in a country like India that has so many diverse languages, it is very, very difficult to say that Indian literature is something that is always written in a specific language. You cannot say that. O.V. Vijayan, who brought about a radical change in the literary sensibility of Malayalam readers in the 1960s with his groundbreaking novel Kazakhinte Itihasam, was in the habit of saying that one knows a region by its characteristic fauna. All right, appam engenaana O.V. Vijayan, you all are very much familiar with O.V. Vijayan. I don't need to explain, you must know him better than I do any day. So what O.V. Vijayan did is like when he wrote Kazakh in the Itihas, and when it was published in the year 1969, it completely changed the literary sensibility of Malayalam readers. Alle orikkilum chindikkatha reethiyilulla karyangalana with his magical realism and everything in that novel. All right, he completely changed the worldview of Malayalam literature, is what I should say. All right, and it was him, you know, he said a very very important sentence. He says that to know a region or a region ne അറിയണമെങ്കിൽ ഒരു സ്ഥലത്തിനെ അറിയണമെങ്കിൽ യു കെൻ നോ ഇറ്റ് ഓൺലി ബൈ ഇറ്റ്സ് ക്യാരക്ടറിസ്റ്റിക് ഫോണ വട്ട് ഇസ് ഫോണ ആൻഡ് ഫ്ലോറ ഫ്ലോറ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് വെജിറ്റേഷൻ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അവിടെയുള്ള ചെടികൾ അല്ലേ ആൻഡ് ഫോണ ഇസ് ദി ആനിമൽസ് ഓർ ദി ഹാബിറ്റാറ്റ് യു നോ ദി ആനിമൽസ് ഓഫ് ദ പെർട്ടിക്കുലർ ഹാബിറ്റാറ്റ് അവിടെ താമസിക്കുന്ന മൃഗങ്ങളെയും കൊണ്ടാണ് ആ ഒരു സ്ഥലത്തിനെ അറിയാൻ കഴിയുക എന്നാണ് പറയുന്നത് ദ വെറൈറ്റി ഓഫ് ഫിഷ് ദറ്റ് വൺ ഗെറ്റ്സ് ഇൻ ചെന്നൈ വിൽ ബി ഡിഫറെന്റ് ഫ്രം ദ വൺ ദറ്റ് വൺ ഗെറ്റ്സ് ഇൻ മുംബൈ Tunis or Manchester. Okay, so he's explaining this by the example of fish that are present in different parts of the world. A place name can act as a metaphor for a whole lot of characteristics. So the name of a place is also important, he says, because it gives us a lot of idea about the characteristics of those place. And this would include the smell of the fish one eats. Okay, so it's not only you know aa sthalathine perile aa sthalathine kurichu mathramalla sometimes you get the smell of the fish one eats ennaanu parayunnathu that make up the identity of the people who inhabit that place. So it is with the, you know, with the name of a place you can easily understand what kind of people live there and what is their identity ennalladhu manasilakkan sadhikkum ennaanu O.V. Vijayan parayunnathu. Language as a system of metaphors at a certain level can also be treated as a metaphor for the system built around as a place. Okay, language or a system of metaphors aanu namukku ariyam alle metaphor nammal poetry lo creative writing lo mathramalla nammal oro words parayumbam ningal linguistics il padichu kaanam signifier um signified um thammillulla oru arbitrary relation aanu angane nammal nokkumbam ella words um oru metaphor aanu alle it is signifying something but it has no direct relation to that thing. So angane language or a system of metaphors aayittu nammal kaanumbol okay you can also you know treat language as a metaphor for the system built around a place or sthalathinte engenaana ayinde or build up end systems aanu avade follow cheynathu ennalladum namukku aa language lude manasilakkan sadhikkum. One is known by the language one speaks alle nammal identify cheyna we call ourselves as Malayalis and how is that we are identified by the language that we speak. This is one reason why theorists say that language is ideological. Okay, adondana kore theoristukal parayana enda that language is ideological. Ideological nu parna enda dominating ideas endano adana.